हेलो, यस
अजय,
सर।
इज इट ऑडिबल?
यस सर, यस सर। शैल वी स्टार्ट सर?
या
यस सर। वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल पार्टिसिपेंट एंड टुडे सेशन रिसोर्स पर्सन डॉक्टर बनप्पा एस अंगर सर, माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर ए एस कुशवाहा, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर एंड हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फार्माकोलॉजी। आई एम हार्डली वेलकम टू यू ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजिंग कमेटी इन डे फिफ्थ मॉर्निंग सेशन। AICTE स्पॉन्सर्ड ऑनलाइन शॉर्ट टर्म ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम फेज सेकेंड एंटाइटल्ड कंप्यूटर एडेड ड्रग डिजाइनिंग अ कस्टमाइज एंड इनोवेटिव सॉल्यूशंस टू द क्रिएट ग्रेटर सिंह जार सिंह मेमोरियल कॉलेज ऑफ फार्मेसी बेला पंजाब एंड ऑटोनोमस कॉलेज। इट इज अ ग्रेट प्लेजर टू मी टू इंट्रोड्यूस दिस सेशन स्पीकर डॉक्टर बनप्पा एस अंगर सर। टुडे हिज टॉक ऑन जेब्राफिश एज एन अल्टरनेटिव एनिमल मॉडल इन फार्माकोलॉजी रिसर्च। डॉक्टर बनप्पा एस अंगर करेंटली वर्किंग एज साइंटिस्ट ई डिप्टी डायरेक्टर फार्माकोलॉजी एंड टॉक्सिकोलॉजी डिवीजन ICMR नेशनल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ ट्रेडिशनल मेडिसिन नेहरू नगर बेलागावी कर्नाटका। हिज प्राइम रिसर्च इंटरेस्ट ऑफ एरिया इन फार्माकोलॉजी ऑफ ट्रेडिशनल मेडिसिन रिसर्च ऑन सेफ्टी एंड एफिकेसी ऑफ मेडिसिन थ्रू एनिमल एक्सपेरिमेंटेशंस। ही गाइडेड एंड गाइडिंग रिसर्च स्टूडेंट इन वेरियस रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट पोस्ट डॉक्टरल एम फार्म फार्माकोलॉजी MD आयुर्वेदा M.Tech Bioinformatics and short-term research training also. Dr. Banappa received the numerous research projects granted from the various government agencies like ICMR, DHR, CCRIS, RUHS, Bangalore, and Himalaya Drug Company project also. He has published more than 25 peer-reviewed international and national research papers with good impact factors. Dr. Banappa, member of various academic and scientific bodies like Life Member South Asia, College of Clinical Pharmacology, and affiliated of America College of Clinical Pharmacology. Founder member of Translation India, member Karnataka Ayush Society, National Ayush Mission, Government of India, Life member India of Society of Hypertensions, CPCSE nominee, scientist from outside the Institute of member IAC, mentor volunteers, science educations to school students, and interactive of Vigyan Bharati in association with the NCSPC, DST and CSIR. Member Board of Studies for Interdisciplinary Studies and Research Faculty of Science, KAHER, deemed to be University of Belagavi, Karnataka. Member of Board of Studies, Faculty of Pharmacy, North Maharashtra University, Jalgaon. Member of Expert Panel, Rajasthan Public Service Commissions. Now I am welcome to Dr. Banappa sir. In this sessions, please share your valuable knowledge and experience. Now, welcome, sir, and over to you. Over to you, sir. Hello. Sir, unmute
Hello,
yourself.
yeah, is it audible? Dr. Ajay?
Yes, sir, audible, sir, audible.
Okay, so shall I share my screen?
And share the screen, share.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Okay. One
Yes.
minute.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Continue.
There is some issue. Just a minute, I'll just share my screen. Is it visible?
Hello.
Is it visible, Ajay? Ajay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So there is some technical hitch, so I could
not understand. Yes, sir.
Shall I begin now?
Yes.
Okay. So good morning to one and all. I hope all our the participants are teachers from various institutions from the pharmacy background. I know that I'm initially I first of all at the outset I would like to thank the organizing team for inviting me for this program. I was just thinking that I maybe odd man out because the program is on the pharmacochemistry, but when I made an inquiry with Ajay, Ajay said, sir, it is a relevant one, you can take, because I'm a pharmacologist, I'll be focusing on these model organisms. So one important the area of in a research is the pharmacology safety particularly. So I'll be focusing on that. So first of all, why we do need an animal models of a disease? That's an important question which one has to ask ourselves first. So why we need? When it comes to in general, you can say that medical research relies on these animal models. Why? To understand the cause and the consequence of any exposure. Maybe it's a toxic substance or any therapeutic substance. So what happens to this living organism? That is an important thing. So medical research relies on these model organisms for the development of innovative therapies. That's why we need a model organisms. Then what are those frequently used model organisms? We all know that as a the undergraduate course and postgraduate course, now we all have learned that what are the frequently used model organisms. Like generally, the rodents are being most widely used research model organisms throughout the world, which includes the rat, mice, and also the other the rodents like hamsters, the rabbit, and other model animals also. So with that, is it sufficient, or we need to think beyond that? That is one more question which we have to ask. Then comes the question, why we need an alternatives? If I ask the questions that whether we have to think beyond that, then why we have to think? That is the question we have to answer. So in that case, you know that model organisms, particularly with the rodents, it's a costly affair. Most of these organizations will not be able to manage these the facilities in a required conditions. Of course, it is a mandatory for these research organizations, research institutions, but the standards which is required for the producing a reliable result, reproducible result, it needs some standards which is generally is difficult to manage to the given conditions of economy and the other resources. Ajay, am I audible or
You are audible, sir.
Wonderful. Okay. So then, what are the points which makes us to think for the alternatives is, the one is a cost factor. The second one is relevance factor also. The another one is that the easy, I mean, technology friendly approaches, and some organisms have some advantages, like the one which I'm presenting today, the zebrafish, has several advantages. One amongst that which makes this organism stand out of that crowd is its transparency. I underline it is the transparency. We all need the transparency in our life, but most of the times, no, in our life also we have opaqueness, and also these most of these model organisms, no, by nature, although zebrafish also, when it becomes an adult, no, we all learn by by birth, no, as a child we are transparent generally, no, we express everything openly. But as the we become adult, when we become opaque, in the same way, this, you know, just for the sake of clarity, I'm telling that the zebrafish larvae and the embryos, they are transparent. You can see the organ functioning, whole system functioning in a intact without any invasive procedure. So you need not to do any surgical or invasive procedure. So it is a ethically acceptable. So one of the important, other important question, what made me to think an alternative? You might be asking the questions that, why you thought, sir? It is a difficult journey to pass through. I tell you, if opt, or if you adopt the one which is well established, you will be comfortable. You will not be facing any difficulties. For example, the rodent models are well accepted. Nobody questions about its validity, and you will be comfortable for doing the research. But when you adopt an alternative to it, you have to face a music, you have to face a lot of challenges, but of course it is very enjoyable. I encourage you all that, of course, there is a challenge means there is an opportunity. So I also had a lot of challenges to face, including its scientific validity. Although we are convinced, but we need to have a sufficient data to convince the scientific community and the peer reviewers for their its validity in our experimental objectives. I mean, it's used in experimental objectives. So here, what made me to think for the alternative is the ethical aspect. You know, we all know, in India, the the ethics is a high priority than anything else. It may be, you know, even the good which we are doing to the other creatures, but still we have to think about the pain which we are inducing to the other organisms or these model organisms. Okay, so in that sense, when I was doing the PhD, in the morning we have to come, and before that we generally, you know, we have a practice of doing puja and practicing this non-violence and all this kind of things. And immediately after that you are coming and sacrificing the animal, you have to see the blood and you have to see the suffering of that animal. And then, you know, for the sake of 1 or 2 centimeters of the blood vessels which I used to isolate, it made me like a trauma in my mind, and it hit me. But by the time that time was beyond my control, and I had no option other than doing this the experiment on these animals. So with that experience, no, I just thought. Several times I thought that why I joined this pharmacology. I was interested in that, but when I was supposed to do all these, no, sacrificing the animals every day, it is a trauma. So not only the suffering to the animals, it is for the humans also, which those who do these experiments. If you really consciously, if you observe, if you question yourself that whether you are doing right thing or not, definitely most of the times we may defend that we are doing a science, we are doing a research, but whether that objective is met? If you ask that question, definitely our own conscience will tell you that we are not doing the justice which is required. So for that, now what the measures which we have to take is, we have to go for an alternative to animal experiments before we conduct an experiments on animals. So what are those alternatives? So I was just struggling now to establish the cell culture facility, which is one of the best alternate model. I mean, it's not, of course, a complete organism, but you can definitely do a lot of research using these cell culture models or cell-based assays. That is the one. The second one is that in vitro biochemical assays. The complexity is going to be lost there. Our body is not that simple as we do it in vitro. Taking some the cyclooxygenase enzyme inhibition or these cytochrome P450, that is a CYP assays. So all those things can be done. Of course, it is also very focused and very acceptable research, but when it comes to the translation of our findings, again, it is not the complete organism, and there are several factors which play a role, including the absorption, metabolism, excretion. So many factors comes into the picture. So if you want to do a translational research, then you have to do it in the whole system only. And that is why these model organisms are necessary. But still, even if you if it makes that sense that you have to use, there also you have a choice. So you have to go for the lower sentient model organisms, like it may be a Daphnia, it may be C. elegans, it may be the crustacean organisms. So like that, there are several options which need to be explored before you go for higher organisms like rodents. So as I said, even you can do the crustaceans, that is a brine shrimp larvae lethality assay is also sufficient in some sense. Of course, scientifically, it needs to be done in mammals. Even zebrafish is not a mammal, but still it is being accepted worldwide, and it is adopted worldwide by the scientific community for this modern pharmacology and toxicology research. So we all do this pharmacology experimentation on model organisms, and we also do some assays on alternative model or alternative way of doing the research or assays. So why we are doing it, whether we are achieving that objectives or not, whether we are successful or not, how many of you agree with me that most of the times our result are not reproducible in our own labs, in our own hand? Okay, the same experimenter in the same setup, if you do repetition of the same protocol, most of the times you will not be exactly able to repeat that same findings. So that is the problem. So for that, you need to take care of the several things which we let us see one by one now. So what we all do is to achieve something like, it may be when it comes to my line of work, I'll be doing research on traditional medicine. Traditional medicine is already was in a practice. I'm telling you, it is in the, of course, it is in the practice, but it was successful. It's the main stream of medicine earlier. But now we have the allopathic system of medicine, which is more convincing, but rather than, this modern therapies, there are some theories that the traditional medicine is more effective and safe also. But all those well said, but it is a must that we need to establish the evidence for that, because evidence-based medicine is the more convincing way of doing the practice, medicinal practice. So you know that natural products, most of them maybe participants are from the chemistry background, and some maybe from the I expect some maybe from this pharmacognosy background also. And pharmacologists, most of us, although pharmacologists, we most of the times do a natural product research only. In India, particularly in educational organizations, majorly because that is our own system. Traditional medicine is our own system, and we have several things to do that. Research is, scope for the research is very high in the natural product. And these, you know, natural products are, I can say, currently it is underutilized source. We are sitting on the treasury, but we are searching for the gold. So there is a treasury, we have to utilize it. That is our traditional system of medicine. Okay, so it has a lot of chemical diversity. You can find out the new chemical entities. It may be difficult. Anything which is valuable is not easy. Valuable things comes with the price and effort. So that is a difficult thing which we have to spend the time and effort and a sincere effort in that direction. So bioactive compounds isolated from the natural sources. I need not to tell that the majority of these existing modern therapeutics are derived from directly from natural, or it is a derivatives, synthetic derivatives of the natural origin. So said all these, you know, well acceptable, but despite of all these records of success, the field of this natural product research is, you know, it has witnessed a significant decline, and the reason for that are several the modern advantage, I mean the developments which we can say, like the target-based discovery approach. So now we are focused. Everybody thinks that if you are target-based effort, or if you have adopted a target-based approach, then you will get appreciation, because that looks very lucrative and very scientific, logical. No, you are targeting only the one target, so that you are not touching other biological proteins or some key functions. So you have a desirable effect rather than this toxic effect. In fact, that is not true. And I'm saying this based on the success of this target-based discovery approach. How much success we have today? How many new molecules we have discovered? So that is the fact will tell that target-based drug discovery approach is one of the reason for the failure of our finding the new chemical entities also. If we had as other approach, I have a slide in the future, so I'll discuss that later in a detail. So another reason is a combinatorial chemistry. Chemistry people may be angry with me if I say this, because again, this is also one of the advancement, and it looks very lucrative, but was it more successful compared to that other? I mean to say that whether we are better than this nature. Nature has a high chemical diversity, complex chemical structures are synthesized in the nature, which we easy to identify them rather than synthesizing, because it's very difficult one. The other is the pharmacology point of view, that high throughput screening. So we know it's again, no, we can do 364 or 384 assays at the same time, 96 into multiple times we can do, and it is a faster way, and it produces a lot of data within a given time. But all those things said, but what is the outcome? That is the question here. So high throughput screening and this target-based approach is adopted worldwide in the pharma industry. How much they are successful? That is my question is. So let us see how much we are successful. The other aspects, several challenges which natural product research faces is the difficulties in isolating the pure compounds. I said in the beginning that it's not that easy. Isolating a pure compound from the crude extracts is not an easy job. And identifying their mechanism of action is further complex, because most of the times these phytochemicals are in a complex nature. So it may be multi-targeting. It may be acting on a different targets. So it, the mechanism is complex. It is not easy to understand. So synthesizing this complex structure is also, from the chemistry point of view, I'm telling it is a difficult one. So I'll tell you the story here that where we have gone wrong is, the earlier when I was reading, in undergraduate and before that, so most of the times, in the older days, success rate of this drug discovery, even in the academic institutions, was high. Why? So here I just pause and question all of you that, and you can answer this question. Do you agree with me or not? Dr. Ajay?
Yes, sir.
At that time, questioning, is it possible to have the interaction?
Yes, sir. Just I unmute ourselves.
Otherwise, it is okay. We can have a question sessions later. Just I'll put a question and let them answer in the later also. Okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So there is network issue also. Let me go ahead with this. I will go ahead with the presentation. So I'll tell you the story, which is published. I'm not telling the story which is cooked. Okay. It is published and peer reviewed. Okay. So here the phenotypic comparison between a phenotypic assays and target-based drug discovery approach. In finding these first-in-class medicines, means novel chemical entities, how much the success with this target-based approach and a phenotypic approach. So here you can see that the orange color shows the phenotypic screening and the blue one is the target-based screening. If you see the bar graph given in the right corner, it is very easy to note that 37% of the finding the new chemical entity is with the phenotypes, phenotypic screening method, and the 23% in a target-based approach. So there is a drastic increase of 14% success rate finding the new chemical entities in phenotypic assays. We all are doing research to find something new, not a me too. So in a research particularly, whichever is successful, that we have to adopt. Fortunately, we were thinking that we are unfortunate to have this cell culture facility and we don't have this high throughput screening. Most of the times in academics, we think that it is a disadvantage. But in other way, it is the advantage that we have a directly doing the phenotypic assays in that also in the model organisms, that also again in the higher model organisms, that is the rodents. But my approach is that my contention is to say here is that, of course, you can do that in a higher organisms directly, but if possible, go for these the lower organisms and the other alternatives, so you can reduce the cost and time. Only the successful one, you can do it in the rodent models. That will have a balance between the ethics as well as economy and our research outcome. So this is the issue which I wanted to highlight, the advantage of phenotypic assays. The another slide, it is also published the data only. So you can see here that phenotypic driven drug discovery leads the successful compounds to the clinics within 10 years. Here the simple thing is, we are adopting a in vivo high throughput screening in a small model organisms. You can see here, high throughput screening, you need not to get this confused here. It may be cell based and it may be a small animal based. Small animals doing high throughput, is it possible with the rats, with the mice? It's generally not possible to do the high throughput screening in a rodents. So you need to go for the smaller organisms. There these zebrafish, fish, and other model organisms will fit into this category. In vivo high throughput screening can be done, and the successful lead compounds identified are further taken for the development, and then it will be tested in a mammalian models. Then it goes to the clinical trials, and finally lands in a successful landing in the clinics for the patient utilization. So this is how the time is reduced, cost is reduced, ethics is maintained, everything is possible when it is compared to the target based drug discovery. But when it comes to an reductionist approach and a scientific, this is also scientific, but generally now it's a perception that if you have a target based approach, it is considered as a more scientific. But if you see the success and all the finally, you know, overall outcome, this phenotypic assay is always are the advantageous. So overall effectiveness of this target-based drug discovery is being questioned. It is not questioned by me alone. There are a school of a thought in the research community. I hope now you will also be agreeing with me. Now, if you see the data, 10,000 compounds tested, 250 found effective, 5 goes into the clinical trials and gets 1 into the clinic, means it is successfully launched in the market, but that also gets recalled, means it is withdrawn from the market. So 10,000 compounds and nothing is coming to the clinic successfully. If it comes also, it goes back. So that is why the drug discovery success is very low, and it clearly indicates that really we went somewhere in a wrong way. So what I feel is that this approach itself, if we took a path which is wrong, then you will definitely reach a wrong place. You will never be able to reach a right place. That is my belief, and that is why, you know, I adopted for the alternative but complete model system. So overall, I am coming back to the one, the focus theme of the today's lecture is that alternative to model organisms, but it should be successful also, which should be it should have a complex system, because human body is a complex system. Many of you might agree with me that, you know, you might have read the Harper's book of biochemistry, Harper's. So the earlier when we were undergraduates, you know, it was even just see the Krebs cycle, it was very simply depicted. But the same Harper's book now has a very complex the structure, I mean the picture which is mentioned. It indicates that there is a lot of things being discovered. So we are still understanding that complex system, whole organism, that whole body functions in a different manner, the complex manner, which is not feasible to have that same in a in vitro or these target-based approaches. So the increasing awareness of these limitations of a target-based drug discovery is fueling the interest in finding these novel high-content bioassays. In this novel high-content and high-throughput bioassays, again, you can have these cells also in this, where you can get a phenotypic outcome. So signal will be in the phenotypic form only. So my personal opinion is that we should go for the whole organism. That is also possible to do in the high content or high throughput manner in a 96 well plates. I will show you those pictures in the future slides. I'm not against these cell-based assays. This is one of the wonderful the science where you can understand the pathway specific action of our drugs. That is also one of the best approach. apart from that, no, if you ask me the personally that what do you prefer, then I prefer these live living organisms rather than the cells alone. The another advantage of having this is you can also observe the safety signals also simultaneously. Otherwise, it is very difficult. Now you may be getting only the signals for the its pharmacological actions or these efficacy parameters, but you may not notice these toxic effects. So that's why, particularly off-target effects. When you have a target-based approach, no, you will be using single cells or a similar line of cells together. So that is not giving you that off-target effect. Sometimes, no, that drug which is acting on the liver may be toxic to the kidney or may be toxic to the heart cells, cardiac cells, and it may be neurons gets affected. So if you want to see the whole system, how it reacts, you need to have the living organism, like the model organism for such is the zebrafish is suitable for such things. It was the same thing which already showed that how many approved drugs are discovered from the phenotypic screens and how many are from the target-based approach. Again, no, if you see the track of those successful drugs, they all are derived from these phenotypic assays. So now let us focus on this. After having this all this background information, now let us see that what is the zebrafish and whether it is suitable for our research activities or not. So what is the ideal characteristics or qualities of a model organism? Ideal characteristics of model organism is it should have a similarity with the humans. Otherwise, there is no meaning in the doing research which is not similar to our body functions. So then question comes that similarity means at what level? What are those similarities which we are expecting? What we expect is the model organism should be genetically similar. Means the genes which are there in that model organism should be similar to that of human genes. So whether it is similar or not, let us see one by one now. Genetically, 80% of the genes, which is already, you know, complete genome sequencing is already been done in this model organism. So it is found that 80% similarity with the whole genomes compared to the humans. And when it is specific to the only disease relevant genes, 84% of the similarity is found. So in genetic level, it is similar. So here I have given one picture also to show that anatomic similarity. So again, now we think how a fish can be a model. It is living in the water and it is swimming. Always it will be that's the complete appearance is different than the humans. Then how it can be a model organism? Whether it thinks like a human, whether it has a similar organs, that's the general questions most of us will have. So when you see the its anatomical location, not only the presence of that organisms, even the location also, you can see here that brain is there, heart is there, liver is there, kidneys are there. It's color coded here to make you understand in a simple way. So the blood circulation is there, immune cells are there, which are functionally similar also. Not only the anatomical similarity, the brain, heart, liver, kidney, pancreas, adipose tissues, skeletal muscles. No, just to name a few, most of these organs are existing, except the one which, you know, generally, you know, all of you have that question about the lungs. Of course, the lung structure is not similar to that of human beings because we breathe in a different way, and the animal, these fish, that also breathes actually. There is an exchange of oxygen, but it happens in a different way. So that organ structure is different. Anatomically, it is different, but still it is can also be done. So the physiologically, if you see, it has a cardiovascular system, it has a neural system, means a central nervous system, and the nervous system which I'm talking about, and the immune response is highly similar to that of humans, immune response. Most of our diseases now are immunological, in fact, including not only the infectious, non-infectious diseases also have the immunological origin. For example, the cancer, there is an immune disorder, it is actually the arthritis, immune disorder, and just to name a few. So immunity plays a major role, and immune response is similar to that of humans towards this physical damage, chemical injury, or to the biological challenges which we face, the similar responses are found. The endocrine signaling, that's one more important thing. All these hormonals, and the like, one major disease is the diabetes. Okay, so the then comes, if you are believed the now that now okay, if you accept genetically it is similar, anatomically it is similar, physiologically it is similar, then it is a model, a good model organisms, definitely. But are there any established disease models existing with this organism? Yes, for that also. And if you see the pathophysiological changes which occur, they are also similar. For example, the obesity, all these molecular mechanisms we also can be studied, because the pathway which disease pathway or a pathophysiology of that disease, obesity, diabetes, cancer, all these can be modeled, including the infectious also. We have proposed a model for this the COVID also. Unfortunately, that needs an biosafety level 3. We have up to the level 2. We are getting now the level 3 facility also. Once we get that level 3 facility, we will be doing that also. So that was the concept proposal in the month of April, May, I have submitted. And we are unable to execute that because of this threat, biological threat with this coronavirus. We could not do that in our lab, but the other countries, they are already doing that. So we are not far behind, but still now we have to achieve something unique in that. So the pharmacological and toxicological responses angle also, many of these human pharmaceuticals act similar to that of how they act in humans. For example, if you have a drug, anti-inflammatory drug, which reduces the inflammatory or this recruitment of the neutrophils, the similar effect you can see. In my slide in the future, I have one experiment which we have done in our own lab, that the diclofenac induces the anti-inflammatory effect by inhibiting the neutrophil recruitment. That can be seen. That is used as a standard drug for the comparison. Toxicological responses, very easy to notice, record and monitor. So that the advantages of this model organism is. So as a drug discovery tool, is it useful? Yes. The translational impact or a translational value of zebrafish is being established very in an exponential way. I have some slides in the future. The published articles I will be showing you future. Let us now see what are the unique advantages of this model organism is. The first thing is economical. Economical in terms of what? In terms of money, because money is the first thing which we face a difficulty. As in academic organizations, even in a research organizations also, we have a deficit of fund for the research. So the money, we have to think twice. So we should have an economical way of doing the research. And then comes, do you have a time? So if you do faster in a lesser time, that is better than the doing the things in the very tedious way. So the time is also important, and this model organism is suitable for such things. I mean, it can be done in a faster way. And most of the times now, when it comes to the natural product research, the isolated pure compounds are in a very less quantity. That is a test compound requirement. So if I ask as a pharmacologist, I need in 2 mg at least, Even if in MG also, if I ask the researcher who has isolated that compound, will be upset because he says that, so sir, I don't have that much quantity. I have only few. I could isolate a small amount. Can you do the bioassay? So that's generally we face that. So here this model organism is suitable for such conditions also, where you have a less amount of the test compound. So it has the another advantage, you know, why it is economical is because the organism, this zebrafish, produces large number of embryos. Even one pair is sufficient to produce 300 embryos. So you have 300 animals. If you want to have the same rodents in a 300, you know, you will have to face at least 200 rupees each. So huge amount of the money you have to spend. And that's time required is also very high. So that's why procuring that animals, maintaining the animals in a proper way, all those things are very costly affair. Other thing is no regular supply. Most of the times, no, we don't have the breeding facilities. We are dependent on the suppliers. If you put an indent today, you will get a supply in the next another 6 months. You are 6 months gone in just waiting for this supply of animals. That also don't know that the quality of those animals also, most of the times. This is an experience I'm telling you. Now I'm not blaming any system because the private breeding, how it takes place, it's questionable. If they are maintaining good, then that's okay. So the maintenance cost is also very high in compared to the, rodents compared to this fish. Fish needs less maintenance cost. The other thing is very small size of these, larvas and embryos which we are going to use. That's another advantage. Now you can put them in a 96 well plates. 96 animals in a 96 well plate. So is it possible to house that 96 mice or the rat in that space? It's very difficult. So the transportation, imaging, all those things, it can be easily done. It fits into the microplates. And it has a faster development also. That's one more advantage. You can do the multi-generational studies if you want. So it is economical and continuous supply is there round the year. So the less compound is required for the testing and less time is consumed. That's the advantage from the economy point of view, times, money, and effort spent. So another thing is, it is a technology friendly also. You need not to worry. Now, even sometimes robotic handling systems are available. If you want to, if you have money, you can upgrade them later. I'll not touch upon this because it's not much applicable because we don't have that automation kind of a things anywhere in this, at least in the near future, it's difficult for the Indian research academic organizations to have all those things. So the other point is that high content screening. So due to this optical transparency, you can see the cell, visualize the internal organs, cell response, all those things. So it is very easy. For example, if you want to see the heartbeat, you can see them. Put them in a petri dish and put the drug and see whether that heart rate is increased or not. You can just record the video and you can analyze it, quantify also. And if you don't have the automated software, you have to do it manually. If you have automated softwares, like softwares are also available, so you can do it automatically. You can count the heart rate and the blood flow. So administration of compound is very easy because you can just put it in the water. You need not to administer intraperitoneally. That can be done if you want that, to ensure that it is administered to the into the circulations. You can do that with the help of the micro injection system, or in the adults you can do it with the insulin syringe also. Intraperitoneally you can administer, but if you put it in the water, that is sufficient. You need not to orally administer them, and it tolerates the DMSO also. DMSO is the one important solvent, co-solvent, which is used for making our compounds soluble in the water. So DMSO tolerance is an important criteria. So animal tolerates it at some concentration that you can use. So these the unique features of zebrafish now makes it an one of the ideal model organism for in vivo high throughput phenotypic screening in a microtiter plates. That's another advantage. So then comes that whether it has a human relevance or not. So we have already seen, but with the evidence, no, whether it has a higher chance of translation, you do some research, that remains in the thesis, or it gets published and it remains in the journal. Nobody uses it. That should not happen. So it should have a translational value. So for that, we need to have a animal with the high degree of similarity to the humans, both the genetically, phenotypically, and pathophysiologically. We should have the similar abnormalities, then it is possible, and similar responses should be there. And the of course, I have mentioned it here at the last point, but it is not the nevertheless, no, it is not the no last point. It is ethical issue. It's more important than anything else. Here, the ethical issues are very less compared to the other model organisms, because it is considered as not an animal, first of all, and your regulatory requirements are also not much stringent, particularly in the larval stage and the embryo stage. But in the adults, again, all these ethics apply. You have to follow the CPCSA guidelines and have these 3R principles. I have given you some of these published articles in the slides. So to make you just confident that zebrafish can be used for translational research. For it may be various diseases, like I have given here two things. This is completely a neuroscience from tank to bedside. So you are, whatever you do it in the lab, it should go to the patient bed. I mean, it should be applicable to the patient's utility. So again, here you can see that patient-derived xenografting. So you have a cancer patient and there is an surgical procedure going on. You can just take out those the material which is going to be discarded anyway. Of course, all these ethics permission has to be taken before doing this. So don't consider that the ethics need not to be bothered. Here the ethics is also important. So these tumor samples can be grafted in this model organism and it can be studied further for its growth and as well as what you call the metastasis can also be studied. Even the blood vessel formation, that is the neovascularization. These are one of the important criteria in cancer progression. So the drugs which are inhibiting that blood vessel formation or the neovascularization, that are success going to be in a successful molecules. So this is a facility in our institute, which after my joining, it started with that simple systems. Later on, we have an automated standalone circulatory system also. So with this facility, we have got these embryos. You can see the embryos and inside, it's a chorion, which is transparent, or you can say translucent, so the organisms can be seen and their development can be monitored. So this is how it looks under the microscope here, given the stereo zoom microscope. So with that, these are the adults. When you mate them, you will get these embryos. Embryos look like this, and it's a faster growth. Within these 3 days, they become larva like this. And here it is the heart. I have some videos, if possible, I'll show you that how it looks. So this is the heart and the kidney, the kidney and the liver here. Okay, so this is the photograph where in the video you can see the blood cells moving in this artery. That I'll show later. Here it's unable to play here. So this is the heart. Again, now you can see here the dot dots which you are seeing is the blood cells actually. So they, in the movement, it will be very easy to perceive. I'll show you the later. So the applications of this zebra-based zebrafish based bioassays. Let us see that where all it can be used. And we may be thinking that now it is a completely new model and all those things. It is not the truth. It was demonstrated in 1957 itself, long back, 50 years, more than 50 years ago. It was shown that, and it is published by a researcher called Johns R.W. Now, zebrafish as a bioassay material in testing the chemicals for effect on cell division and differentiation. It's one of the important criteria, no? Cell division, anti-cancer, particularly drugs can be tested in this. Cytotoxic activity of certain flavonoids against the zebrafish embryos. It is also published in 1964. So it's not that new or kind of a thing, but we have not explored it. That's the problem. Now, most of these research organizations are starting this using of this organism. So some of these disease models which can be done in this model organism are just listed here for efficacy study, pharmacological effectiveness. You can see the obesity model, diabetes, induce the diabetes also. You can induce the cancer. You can induce the inflammation and immune disorders, anxiety, Parkinson, epilepsy, and other Alzheimer's disease models can be developed in this model organism. And apart from that, infectious diseases, cholera, tuberculosis, already people are using it. And for the another important criteria is the safety pharmacology, means whether it is effective or not, cardiovascular system, central nervous system, and GAD. Apart from that, you can do also the toxicity testing. Acute toxicity, there are OECD guidelines developed with these model organisms, developmental toxicity, carcinogenicity, cardiotoxicity, hepatotoxicity. No, name anything can be done like that. This model organism is, but in the beginning, it is difficult to initiate, but once it is done, definitely one can do the studies. So the model, few published articles on that, including our own. I'll show the in the future slides our own publications and our own work. Now let us see this the published article, that's diet-induced obesity in zebrafish, which shares these common pathophysiological pathways with mammalian obesity. Then what you need, if it is similar to that mammalian obesity, all pathways are same, then it is easy to do. So, and that also with the diet induced model. So generally, why we prefer the diet induced obesity is, most of the times in humans also, it's because of the overeating. So it's more relevant to do the research in the screening with this identification of the biomolecules by microfractionation and quantitative analysis by the NMR and other methodologies for the quantitative assay. So these are the some more examples of the drug discovery using this organism. So you can just see, just for the your shake-up, just to introduce that it is well accepted. Otherwise, just people have a skepticism. This, our research will not get recognized, our research will not get published if we are not using the organism or the test system, which is most accepted. That's the wrong one. Of course, we may face some challenge, but it is not the difficult one. So that's why I showed you that all these papers, spotlight on zebrafish, translational impact. No, we don't have any time and money to do the basic kind of innovative kind of a research or in-depth basic research. What we need is a translational research, in fact. We are facing a lot of difficulties in the health sector. We need drugs. So translation is important for us, and for that we need to have a suitable models for the translational value or translational impact. So that's why all these three publications are relevant to the translation only. So from tank to bedside, here the bench to patient, like that, several organisms opinion articles are published. Not only that, no, it's relevant for the vaccine research also. Nowadays, no, we, as I said, now we have proposed a model for this, for the drug study as well as vaccination safety and vaccination development against this COVID-19. Unfortunately, now because of this lab biosafety level 3 facility which is required, it's still pending. We are expecting to get that in another 1 month. So we may take up such studies in the future. So it is an alternative model organisms for both human and animal vaccination research. Why this animal vaccination is important is these zoonotic diseases or the threat for humans. Actually, that the disease is affecting the animals, including this COVID. No, it is anticipated or to be established, of course, that it has come from the bats. The present literature or this evidence shows that it is from the bat. So that animals, if it is vaccinated, most of our diseases like KFD, Kassner forest disease, which is one of the important disease in this, particularly in these Western Ghats, where there's now it is transmitted through the monkeys. So that virus is a threat for human habitats here. So animal vaccination is also important compared to the human vaccination also. That's why we need to have a model organism which is having the similarity with the humans. So this is the article which we have published. Here that one of the important drug, neglected drug, you can say that, because olanzapine is used as an antipsychotic, and generally that psychotic patients are neglected. So if they get obesity also, nobody bothers. So this is an observation clinically, and olanzapine induced obesity, olanzapine induced hypertension, which we done along with my guide, Dr. B.M. Patel sir, for several years. And this is another effort there, no, alternative models. We have published that olanzapine-induced hypertension in rats in the European Journal of Pharmacology in 2006. After that, again, no, we are using those rodent models only. That when we thought that can we use this zebrafish for this olanzapine-induced obesity, we have done one study with the as a PG project. This Pukari was our PG student. He did work here with me, and we have published this. So apart from that, now we have also several other pharmacological and toxicological assays using this model organism actually. So there are several herbal drugs which needs to be tested for its toxicity. So the OECD guideline 236 describes about this method in zebrafish larvae. So that's what we have done, and we have found a very interesting result here, you can see, and which is almost relevant to the rodent data. So cardiotoxicity we have done, and acute toxicity we have done. So these are the developmental toxicity, which we have noted that the teratogenic potential of the compounds. So apart from that, we have done an inflammatory response also. Now I was saying you that leukocyte migration is the first response towards the injury, neutrophil recruitment. So that can be studied. Drugs which are I don't have the sufficient time to explain all these methodologies. These are available anywhere. Of course, you can just briefly, I will tell you that this once you induce an injury, physical injury, by damaging its tail fin and exposure of the drug, without exposure, with exposure, you can compare. after that different time intervals of exposure, you can fix that and you can stain with the Sudan block. It's a simple assay. So where these neutrophils can be counted, which can be visualized and counted, that how many cells have come. So I'll show you the slide. I hope I have here. Sorry, it's not there. The leukocyte migrations staining slides, which can be easily seen and it can be counted. Apart from that, now we have also done a metabolic rate assay and lipid accumulation quantification in this model. So these are the quantification of lipid in these larvae. So here what happens is you just feed them with the high lipid diet, high fat diet to the larvae. So there will be an accumulation of the fat. So if you have a drug which is reducing that fat accumulation, it can be easily quantified. So the conclusion is that it is one of the best model, very promising model. Dr. Ajay was asking me, sir, please deliver a lecture which is particularly on the zebrafish. So I have chosen this model organism to present here. I hope I have done my level best, although there are several lacunas in this. One more the important caveat is that although I said several positive points, yet this model organism needs validation. Validation can be only done by experimentation by the different researchers. So that's why the research is required. So these are the team members for lab, and this is our institute. Thank you all very much for the your patient listening. This is an few slides. This is an embryo, which how it looks like. So thank you, Ajay.
Thank you very much, sir, for knowledgeable sessions. Now the time is query sessions from the side of the participant. I am requested to you and for all of audience, if you have any query, please write in the chat box. I have received both queries from the participant side. Ashwini Misra, he asked to how can we get this phase from the experimentations?
Sorry, how?
How can get this phase from the experimentations? Procurement, sir.
Procurement aspect, no. Yes, the procurement is possible with the research laboratories only. Now that the rodents which are available in the market, the supplier for this fish in the future, you may be getting them. But right now, you have to collaborate with the researchers. So you can get them from these researchers only.
Yes, sir. Another question is from Ashok Behra, sir. How are you developing the model in zebrafish? Please explain in respect of asthma, Alzheimer, and inflammation model. How can develop this model?
Yes, Alzheimer's already well established models are there for this. Ochadiac acid induced Alzheimer's model is a well-established model, very gold standard, I can say, compared to that other models. But for the asthma, it is now challenging, because as I said, there is no lung or this tracheal tissue which is visible or which is existing. Cells are there, of course. Gill cells, they are cells which are functioning that exchange of the oxygen. So if you have a study objectives relevant to that, you can do it. But it is very difficult to do the asthma studies as of now. Any other disease you mentioned?
Disease, he asked about Alzheimer disease, anti-inflammatory, you have already. And one more question from Riya Gupta. Hello.
Okay.
One more question from Riya Gupta. Please let me know if we are pursuing for anti-inflammatory actions, one model for acute and chronic will be sufficient for, will be the validate with other formulae and collagen histamine also.
If you are submitting your data for the regulatory requirement and all, it is required to be as of now, because until there is an acceptance from the regulatory authorities, you cannot submit this data. But it's definitely from the research point of view, for the publications, for the further screening or shortlisting the drugs for this evaluation in the mammal models, this can be adopted.
One more question from Ashok Behra, sir. How to validate the model? Can you please share your email and contact number related further?
I'll share
cancer
it. I hope I have my email ID here. Oh, sorry. I'll put my slide here, one more slide, so you can note down. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Visible.
Okay. So these are the my email IDs. The participants can note down. And if there are any doubts, let me know that. Now I can discuss with them. So this is my phone number, and these are the my email IDs, and this is my address. Okay. Is it clear, or they have anything else to clarify?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Clear.
Okay.
Sir, one more question from James Patel.
Okay.
He asked related to development of enzymic inhibition activities in zebra rats.
Enzymic inhibition. Which enzyme they want to target?
Hello.
Which enzyme they want to target?
Yes, sir. It is possible.
Yeah, why not?
No, sir. He have just asked. It is possible.
Yeah, because it is existing, and there are tracers available for
Hello?
That. For example, substrate conversion can be studied in that.
Yes, sir. He asked to in about renin enzyme.
Okay. It must be possible. We have not done it, but it must be possible, because that renin angiotensin system is existing in this. Angiotensin receptors are there, angiotensin is there, it can be, it
sir,
must
he
be.
Want about asking in a renin enzyme and 5-loxo enzyme.
Okay, good. That let yes, the candidate know, we can have that discussion in an elaborated
yes,
way, that we have to focus on that, because it was not a part of this presentation, so I didn't have that details of it with me now. Okay. Ajay? Hello? Hello, Ajay?
Hello.
Hello.
Very,
Hello.
Very good morning, sir. Respected Dr. Banappa S. Unger. Actually, there is some problem in internet connection from his side.
Okay.
And,
okay.
Almost all the queries has been taken, sir. Now, kindly permit me to conclude this session.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. And thank you for the opportunity. I'm very much happy. Thank you.
Hello. Sir, we want to conclude this session. And I found this session very amazing. This session gave us an insight into the zebrafish model for the behavioral and genetic toxicological studies. And we understood that this animal has homology with the mammals. And we became aware with the numerous advantages of this animal model in the test of efficacies and safety of the therapeutic agents and vaccines. The AICT-sponsored online STTP organizing team and the participants want to thank you for sparing your valuable time to speak on this recent topic. And I feel that your in-depth studies on this experimental model would be highly beneficial for the participants in widening their choice of models to test the new therapeutic agents. Please accept our sincere appreciation for your outstanding and stimulating presentation. And it's time to honor you with the token of appreciation for conducting this session, sir. And the certificate, your certificate is displaying on the screen. I think it is visible to you also.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. It's visible.
Yes. We will email you the soft copy of this certificate and post the hard copy.
Thank you.
Sir, thank you again for your contribution. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, madam. With your permission, I will leave.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay. I'll take a leave.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.